Now, today's keynote speaker is someone whose work exemplifies how these worlds can be brought together to extraordinary effect. I've been a huge fan of his work for a long time. He is the first chief digital officer at the Metropolitan Museum of Art, leading a world-class team of 70 working on integrating digital, social, mobile, video, data, apps, and more. He joined the Met Museum after spending 20 years at Columbia University on the faculty of the Journalism School and a year as the university's first chief digital officer. In 2014, he was named the most influential chief digital officer in the United States. In 2015, he was named to Fast Company's list of the 100 most creative people in business, in part for the work he and the museum are doing to build the future of culture. He is a 5-time TEDx speaker, and most recently, he joined CBS Radio's new Play It podcasting network with the eponymously titled At Sree Show, talking tech, culture, and entrepreneurship. Please join me in welcoming our keynote speaker for TechniCulture 2016, Sree Sreenivasan.
Hello, good morning, everybody. Good morning, Philadelphia. I'm going to ask you to pull out your phones and get on Facebook. So if you would do that, please, or get on Twitter, one of the two. If you're on neither of them, just you have a wonderful, very intellectual life, so I hope you enjoy that life that you have. What I'm gonna ask you to do is to go on to either Facebook or Twitter, and right now we're broadcasting live on Facebook. And what you do is you find me on Facebook, Sree Sreenivasan, and you can just hit share, and suddenly everybody you know can be invited to join us here this morning. If you're on Twitter, I have shared my slides from the presentation, so you can share that if you prefer instead. So you can do one of the two, or you can just, again, sit back and relax and enjoy the conversation. I'm gonna be speaking for about 40 minutes, and I hope to have some time for Q&A in there as well, and we'll see how the morning goes. I did want to start by showing you the most important tweet in Philadelphia over the last 24 hours. How many people have already seen this tweet? A few of you, all right. So I think every few years, the Eagles have a new hope, right? And Carson Wentz is that new hope. And he says he's going to fly, Eagles, fly, along with all of you. So I wish you all the very, very best. We know how much of a crazed sports town you folks are, so I'm glad that you have new hope. I also want to show you something I posted earlier this morning. I was watching two Philly guys on ESPN. That's Kevin Nagandi, who some of you know on ESPN Sports Center, 7 a.m., 7 to 10 a.m., and Stephen A. Smith, who some of you know, again, with Philly Connection. So I love being in Philadelphia, one of my favorite cities. And in 1995, I spent a summer teaching in Philly and Conshohocken, Pennsylvania. And someone said, wow, Conshohocken is the center of tech startups, so that makes sense. But this was 1995. I don't think the internet had quite arrived in Conshohocken. But I was here teaching television when New York Times Television was actually based here in Philly and Conshohocken. It was a wonderful, wonderful experience. And today, I'm going to share with you some of my lessons from working in the world of arts and technology and working at the Metropolitan Museum of Art. I know we have this incredible collection of folks who have much more experience in the world of arts than I'm just going to move this here. I'm sorry. I think I have my own microphone, so I think we'll use that and see how that goes. The tech folks can tell me if I need to switch. The people here who have much more experience in the arts and are doing fantastic work here in Philly, and I hope throughout the day you will get a chance to see and hear from the folks who are making a difference locally and that you will get to connect with them. Unfortunately, I'm on a 10:30 train back to New York, so I'll miss the opportunity to talk to you in person, but we can continue the conversation online. I'm gonna walk as far away as I can. You have my contact information there, my email address, as well as my Twitter and Instagram feed. And the most useful thing I can probably invite you to is my closed Facebook group here called Sree's Advanced Social Media. If you're on Facebook and you search up Sree's Advanced, Sree apostrophe S Advanced, you will get my closed Facebook group where there are about 2,000 people who work in technology and social media around the world, including people who work at Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, etc. And you have a question or comment that you want answered right away, there'll be somebody awake in the world who will answer you. And it's a great community, not because of me, but because of the folks who are there. And I learn from that community every day. So let's get a sense of how many of you were able to share my slides from on Twitter already. Raise your hands if you've done that. Look around you. Very active group. Very nice. How about how many people have shared on Facebook, the Facebook video, the live video? Very, very cool. And I hope we'll be trending using TechniCulture. We'll be trending in Philadelphia, if not nationwide, throughout the day. Let's make that happen. It'll only happen if you folks actively tweet and share what's happening. And the reason I do all this is to make sure that we are sharing the great information that other speakers are going to be giving you, not me, but the others who are participating. But also to think about this new world we live in. That's why I'm experimenting with Facebook Live. What does it mean when you're able to suddenly bring people around the world to you and show them what they're doing? At the Met, we are big believers in showing, within reason, behind the scenes work. And we believe Facebook Live, Periscope, and these other tools are great ways to do that. I'm a bigger fan of Facebook Live than I am of Periscope, because Periscope videos disappear in 24 hours. And I'm not in the business of making ephemeral content. I want content that will last. Because as you will see when I speak, one of my thoughts is that most people aren't seeing your content, and we have to spend a lot of energy getting people to our content. So I want it to have longer legs. That's why we spend more time on Facebook Live. But Periscope, Livestream, Ustream, all of those tools I think are very important for cultural organizations. The audience is craving access. Donors are craving access. And the two things that, and the thing that we all have in cultural institutions is access that we've been controlling, and we can share that in smart, strategic ways. I've been at the, as you heard, I've been at the museum for about 2.5 years, and I always start by remembering my days as a professor for 21 years at Columbia, and starting with ABC. Always be charging your phone. Who here is charging their phone right now? Anybody? Nobody. All right. So our grandchildren are not going to believe that grown adults were on their hands and knees at airports looking for juice, right? So you must have some kind of charging device with you at all times. You can get kind of lipstick size chargers. You can get a bigger size. And then if you're really crazy like I am, you can get this bad boy that gives you 10 charges. It's also a weapon, so you can hit somebody across the head. And you can also make great friends at airports because you carry your own supply of electricity. It's so important for us as we are adapting to a digital world that we have the ability to use technology, and you're powerless without electricity. And so I urge you to think about how you can make sure you have the technology you need. I recommend a case that's on my phone. By the way, Kevin, my new friend Kevin, is broadcasting live to the world on Facebook over there. And I use a case called Mophie, M-O-P-H-I-E. I make no money from anything I'm talking about, you should know. But I recommend it. It's a battery pack and a case. So that's really, really helpful. If any of you have seen the TV show Monk with Tony Shalhoub, one of the great actors, I tell people you should go into a room and be like Monk, where you're looking for juice, looking for power anywhere you can get. Well, one of the things I also forgot to say right at the beginning, people in Philly know how to eat. Did you see that breakfast spread? Did we thank the folks who've organized this conference? I don't think we have. Not just for the very nice food, but also bringing us all together. And one of the things that we are trying to show at the Met through our events, through all we do, is the convening power of the Met. And now you see the convening power of the at Phila culture. Second, always be connecting. One of my thoughts is we should be connecting with people when we don't need them, so that they're with us when we need them. And this is a great way to think about donors, a great way to think about audiences, a great way to think about employees. Social media allows you not to have to do what we had traditionally done, which is ask people for something. So I tell folks, don't be an ask on social media. There was a K in there, but if you didn't hear it, that's okay. And in Germany, somebody tweeted, Sree says, don't be an ass on social media. Which is true, but I didn't say it, but that works. So what do I mean by that? I mean that we should be thinking about our work as a way to do what I call low-touch relationships, meaning you're keeping people connected, you're dealing with them, but you're not asking them for something. And then when you are ready to ask them for something, they respond because you haven't been asking for them all along the way. And you will see an example of that, what we do at the Met. We want to be in the business of sharing and giving a lot more than we ask. And that's part of our public mission as cultural institutions, but it also makes great business sense as well. And then finally, and so the other way to think about always be connecting is that connect with people when you don't need them. So if I mention someone on social media, connect with them right now, even though you don't need them for anything, right? So for example, Paul Wright, our MC, you saw him up here. You haven't really connected with him. So let's track him down on Twitter. He is chead95, C-H-E-A-D-95 on Twitter. I'm sure there's a wonderful story from his college days in there. You'll have to ask him at lunch, but track him down on Twitter, follow him. You don't need him for anything, but maybe one day you will. So that the first time he hears from you is not an ask. Does that make sense to everybody? That's the way we should be working as much as possible. And finally, always be collecting. And that means what I see many of you doing, using your phone as a collection device. Take out your phones, and you see a slide, take a picture. I've already tweeted my slides. Here's the URL for the slide, bit.ly/SreePhilly. So if you have that, you can just take a picture. There are about 40 slides in there, and 40 slides is like having 400 slides. You will never look at them again. But throughout the day, if you have a handful of slides you've taken pictures of, look at you taking out your phones. Very good. You'll be able to look at them when you're waiting at the bus and other places. Now, some of you are really smart and are saying, he said he has 40 slides and he spent 15 minutes on one slide. How the heck is he going to do this? So I'm obviously going to go a lot faster at some point, but you get the idea. Now, according to Twitter counter, I'm the 84,000th most important person on Twitter, which tells you sort of how desperate Tracy Buchanan was. The 83,000th person on Twitter was not available, and so I had to come from New York to help you guys. This conference you thought was very high standards, but you know at least the opening keynote's not very high standard. This is a picture of the Met, and if you haven't been to the Met and seen the outside of it in a mess, that means you haven't been there in about 5 years, which is our plaza just been recently redone in about 18 months ago. And I love showing this picture. It's even better when you look at it on your phone or your screen if you're following along on my presentation, because this addresses directly why we're all here. This is a picture taken by one of our photographers, Eileen Travell, who's amazing on Instagram. You can follow her, Eileen Travell, with two L's. And what she has done is she took this photo with her iPhone 5 across the street from the Met. And you'll say, well, what does this say about what we're all here for? This is a photo that she took with her iPhone. If I'd taken it with my Nikon, it would have been terrible, but this tells you expertise matters. Before I came to the Met, I was at Columbia, where I was dean of students and in charge of admissions, career services, and things in journalism. And people would say to me, how can you charge Ivy League prices for an industry that's dying? And I would say, journalism isn't dying. There's more journalism being consumed, created, and loved than ever before. It's the business model that's wobbly. And in a world where everyone's a writer, the trained writer stands taller. In a world where everyone's a photographer, the trained photographer stands taller. And in a world where everyone loves the arts institutions stand taller. But you have to be involved and really understand how technology works to make that happen. So I love showing people this photograph. Please take a look at it on your screens as well. Oops. There's a daytime view, and here's a nighttime view of the same space. At the Met, we think about four spaces. Our director, the head of and CEO of the Met, Tom Campbell, who's at Thomas P. Campbell on Instagram, you get what I'm doing, right? You start following these people when you don't need them, right? He says that we have four spaces. We have the Met Fifth Avenue. We have the Met Cloisters. Has anyone been to the Met Cloisters, which is in Uptown? Wow, look at that. Amazing. But someone posted on Instagram the other day, I love going to the Cloisters. It reminds me of Game of Thrones. It's a medieval garden. And this is the Met Broyer, which many people have been mispronouncing to me even since I got here. This is our new location where the Whitney used to be. And it's pronounced Broyer, like lawyer or voyeur, depending on your interest. But you know now, you'll never forget how to pronounce it, right? Met Broyer. And he said, so we have three physical spaces and we have a fourth space, the digital Met. And all four are of equal value. That's a huge leap for an arts institution to say that all four are of equal value. This would be as if the SEPTA folks said that there's equal value in people visiting the SEPTA train website as it is in people sitting on the train. It's not true, but in the arts world, it can be true because we're nonprofit, because of our mission-driven work that we have. Recently, we were named on TripAdvisor's list of top 25 museums, which is very, very kind, very humbling, but also awkward in some ways, because you can imagine there's no difference between number 1, 25, 30, 50, 60, but there is something, a lesson here, and that is that people are making their decisions not just on reading the very fancy newspaper or experts, it also, they're deciding based on what the crowd is saying. And so we have to be as attuned to the crowd as we are to the experts. So even though I say expertise matters, there is a role for other kinds of technology. I love to say how big the Met is compared to the Empire State Building, and now you can see the size and see what's going on there. I know a lot of us think about millennials and how they interact with us. You may know the stat that this week, the number of millennials has overtaken the number of baby boomers. Who are the boomers in the room? Okay, and you don't have to be shy about it, that's okay. Millennials, raise your hand. All right, even in this room, there are more millennials than boomers, so that's interesting. So anyway, so this is something that Damon Kiyosawa said, and Damon is a terrific journalist who's written this essay. So you can click on my slide to get to his essay if you're following along online, or you can just tweet at him and say, hey, at D. Kiyosawa, we're talking about you in Philly. And look what he says. And substitute the word arts organization or culture or something similar for wherever you see the word journalism. So I'm going to use the word arts. While much of the arts being produced by legacy cultural organizations is of value to younger audiences, it does not entirely speak their language or fully reflect their lives. What do you think that means? What do you think that means? What is an example that you can think of in Philadelphia about how either journalism or arts organizations aren't connecting with folks? Question? Anybody? Yeah, go ahead.
I think art criticism is a place in which there's a real disconnect between traditional news journalism and how younger readers want to find out about what art they want to go see.
So that's a great example. Another one? Yes? So we're not speaking, so the marketing isn't speaking to places where they live. Give us an example specifically.
I think that there are a lot of arts institutions that still are not yet using video and are not putting those videos on the platforms where millennials are living.
Yeah, I think that's a great example. By the way, Fran describes herself as a storyteller. We just met this morning and I said, what do you do? And she said, storyteller, and I love that because I always say my work at the Met is very clear, to tell a million plus stories about our million plus works of art to a billion plus people. And I think the future of all business is storytelling. How are we doing on Facebook?
Great.
All right, we have people from Malaysia and the Bronx watching, so we're all covered, we're well covered. Yeah. Hi.
Hi, I have one more for you. I think
as a boomer, many of us grew up having things curated for us.
Mm-hmm.
And I think in the millennials, and I watch my children and other young folks, have a sense of curating for themselves. They want to pick, they want to choose. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of our organizations are still grounded and mired in this idea that we're going to select and present for you.
That's a great comment and a great point. And I think there's room for both. Working at the Metropolitan, where we have 100 wonderful curators, I would say there's immense value in curation, but there's also value in letting people walk around and fend for themselves in a way. We think about a lot about that in terms of our wayfinding. You know, people always ask me at the Met, how come you don't have a GPS in your app? Right, you're Mr. Technology, you've been there for 2.5 years, how come there's no GPS? And I say, we have GPS at the Met. We call it guard positioning system. You ask a guard, they tell you where to go. It's so easy. And we have 600 security guards at the Met. So they'll always steer you the right way. By the way, yesterday at the V&A, did anybody catch this on Twitter? The V&A got rid of all their maps for a day in the entire museum and said, get lost at the V&A or find yourself at the V&A, some kind of clever way of doing that. So go back and take a look. How would your institution feel if they pulled away the maps or, you know, some other way of giving people less direction? And we wonder about that all the time at the Met. We relaunched our own maps, and you can find that we launched a digital map that you can find online, and we want to be careful about directing people and then forcing people to go in a certain way, because getting lost at museums is part of the point of going to great museums and something we can think about. I was interviewed by a journalist last year about technology trends, and I said the trends of today are things like podcasting and blogging and email newsletters, and people start laughing because it's all 2006 technology. Why are they so popular now? Because the ability to make them and the ability to consume them have become so good, right, and so easy. So I want to make a pitch for something called the skim. Anyone here reading the skim? Raise your hand. Wow, look at this. Let's show everybody all the hands up. So the skim has two M's in it. Follow it on Twitter. And the skim is an email newsletter aimed at millennial women. And I'm not a millennial woman, but I insist everybody subscribe to this. It is fantastic. We brought the women from the skim to the Met and said, teach us. How are you so good at email? At the Met, we take email very seriously, and that's one of my other points. In a Snapchat world, email still counts, right? The reason we're here is because Tracy Buchanan emailed me, right? She didn't like Snapchat at me or anything, and so that's why I'm here. So email still counts. At the Met, we send out about 72 million emails a year, and one of our members said she gets every one of them. But email still counts. And I was asked about what are your competitors at the Met? Who are your museums that you compete with? And I say, we don't compete with museums. None of us do. You're not competing with each other. That's why you're all here, because we're all learning together. Our competition is Netflix, Candy Crush, Life in 2016. That's what we're competing with, right? So let's think about ways in which we can use the magic of all of us convening to get great ideas. So one of the things that I recommend people do at my sessions, but I would love for you to do it at the entire day, is to take out a piece of paper or your computer or your screen, whatever you have, and make two columns. Things to try now and things to try later. For my particular session, you may want to have a third column saying, I can't believe they brought this guy down from New York. What a waste of time this guy is. But annotate the day, because otherwise you're going to be bombarded with so many great, useful, wonderful, shocking, scary things that if you don't annotate your day, you're going to get lost. We always think about what social media can do for you, and social media can help you connect with your audiences in better and smarter ways, and there are many things that they can do here as we list. I also got some lessons on social media from Roger Ebert, the great Roger Ebert, who died almost exactly 3 years ago. And I never met him, but I learned so much about how to do social media from Roger. And the first point there is be interesting in real life. Also, learn how to spell interesting. How many people caught the typo right away? Oh, look at you. I showed this to hundreds of people before someone said, you know, you can't spell. Be interesting in real life. That's one of my big messages to all of us in the cultural space. We are already interesting, right? If you're good in real life, you can be great on Twitter. But if you're great in real life, you can be awesome on social media. But if you're bad in real life, you're going to be awful on social media. And that's what all of us need to be thinking about. All our institutions are doing fantastic work. How do we use social to amplify what we're doing? And that's something that you can think about. Also wanted to share with you some tools that I love. I believe that if you're on social media, you should be creating what I call thumb stoppers. What's a thumb stopper? Something that stops the thumb all day long. People are going on their feed like this, right? They're going like this. So what will stop them? An image, a video, a GIF, something's going to stop. So whenever you post, if possible, think about having some kind of image there. Does that make sense as you think about it? So think about a thumb stopper. So I want to show you a tool that's so easy to make thumb stoppers, Canva. Anybody here using Canva? A few people, look at, they all know something. Canva is a free tool that helps you make images, graphics, and they even have them for the right size, for Facebook, for Instagram, for Twitter, all of that, and it's done very, very nicely. Allthefreestock.com, created by a guy named Saijo out in California, in Australia, stock footage and photos available. And then I want to make a point about the importance of influence. All of us want eyeballs to our work, right? That's a very important part of what we do. I had said here, help create, you know, bring eyeballs, traffic, and attention to our work. That's what we want to do. Point number three. So we want as many people to see our work as possible, but it's also important to get influential people to see our work. And this tool, whosharedmylink.com, shows you the number of bloggers and journalists who share your content, as opposed to just the masses. And if someone reminds me at the very end, I will show you a tool I love to help you find your 100 best people to follow. I mean, the most influential people already following you. Who are they? If I asked you, do you know your 100 most influential? You're unlikely to. I didn't until I started using this tool. So someone remind me at the very end. The scarcest resource of the 21st century, said Les Hinton, is human attention. And this is something that I'm always thinking about. And right now you can tweet at Les Hinton and bring him from New York right down to Philadelphia. Just say, hey, at Les Hinton, we're talking about you at TechniCulture. And send him this. Why is it so hard? Because there are 1 trillion photographs will be taken in 2015, or were taken last year, and this year the number is going to grow. So it's not enough just to have great work. We have to bring eyes to it. There's a gentleman named Sal Khan. Anyone know who Sal Khan is? Salman Khan, Sal Khan. Sal is the creator of Khan Academy. And he came, we're doing a pilot project with him. By the way, the way you get work done at a great institution is to have pilot projects. And sometimes I feel we have more pilots than JetBlue. And you know that Khan Academy gives away free education, right? And he said something to me that was very distressing. He said that the vast majority of people whose lives I can change tonight have never heard of my service and will never hear of my service. So if you can't give away free education, how the heck are we going to get people to come to our opera or come to our museum or come to anything else? It is so important what he said. And that has caused me to think about everything we're doing has to have obviously an external marketing plan, but an internal marketing plan. Almost everything you do has to have its own plan on how you're going to get the word out. Just doing great work is no longer enough. And that's something that journalists have learned the hard way. In the old days, you'd write your story, and there would be a copy editor who would fix it, and then there was a way to get it out into the audience. Now you have to bring your own audience. And so journalists are becoming really smart at social media because they have no choice. But arts organizations haven't needed to do that, and now they need to do it. And this is the moment where I want to make a reference to the New York Times digital work. Some of you have seen that the New York Times is killing it digitally online, right? You guys have seen what they're doing.
And I, by the way, subscribe to a print daily newspaper, The Times, and I love it. Everyone on my hallway in Manhattan gets the print New York Times or the Wall Street Journal. I don't know how long that'll last, but it's still going strong. But the reason they're able to do so well is because they're under existential threat. You know, this is the part of the movie where the asteroid has arrived and Bruce Willis is like scrambling to make a rocket, or someone's like digging a cave, or someone's going to Mars. Like, that's the moment. So what happens? There's nothing like an existential threat to clear your mind and focus on the task at hand. But what do we do when we're not under existential threat? Cultural space is not under existential threat. That's the moment for us to innovate and try new things. And that's why watching these folks who are under existential threat is great, so that we can learn. And you should know that by the time the asteroid arrives, it is too late, right? So we need to be doing new things, and that's why TechniCulture is so great, that you're all together and thinking about this stuff now. Now, when I was young, I wanted to be a millionaire, and I became a millionaire, but it was in the wrong category. I've got to tell you, the saddest number is not that number. What's the sadder number? The drafts. How many wonderful invitations have I started saying yes to that I didn't? How many other great opportunities did I start saying yes to? So one day when I'm retired, I'm going to watch this and cry as I look at all my old emails. So we're going to just go through some of these things. You can look at them later. You all have the presentation. In fact, you can leave now and get some great breakfast again, and come back in time for the next good speaker. Here are minutes from the 1967 curators meeting, and it says, the use of an IBM computer is being seriously considered by the Met. And Mr. Watson of IBM is bringing us along. Who's Mr. Watson? He's the president of IBM, the chairman of our board. This would be as if Mark Zuckerberg was chairman of our board, and he says, I have this new service, I want you to try it. And we're like, we're not so sure, right? Dr. Fisher doubts a computer would be a time-saving device. So I got to tell you, I used to hide his name from this presentation, because it's unfair for any of us to have our 40-year-old minutes pulled out. So I used to hide his name. But then, thinking about it, maybe Dr. Fisher was right after all. So I give him full props now, and I reveal his name in all its glory. There you see it. We're not ashamed of you, Dr. Fisher. We're proud of you, what you said back then. So what are we doing at the Met? We believe that we are a kind of media company where we're publishing. I believe every institution needs to be a media institution. You need to be publishing. The scale of it may be different, but we all have to do it. 500 blog posts sounds like a lot. It is for us. But at the New York Times, that's what they do in a month. At the Huffington Post, that's what they do in a day. At BuzzFeed, they do that in an hour, right? Right? They're all, it's just a matter of scale and volume, but that's what we're doing. And you can see that, right? So we do 100 new videos that are produced by our Emmy award-winning team. Chris Noe, who's amazing, follow him on, some of you know him, Christopher Noe, follow him on Instagram or on Twitter. And so, you know, they make 100 videos, but we are also making informal videos like this, right? This is going out on my personal account, but you get the idea, that we're always producing content. An example of what we've done, you all know the audio guide that you all have, you see when you travel. We found that we wanted to get more people to listen to the audio. People love the audio, but New Yorkers don't love renting a device. Why? Because it says tourist, right? So what do? We freed the content, and right now, if you went to your phone, metmuseum.org/audioguide, you can listen to all those exhibitions you're missing, right? You can listen to all our stops on there right now. So how do we make people connected to our content? That's one of the things that we're thinking about. We still rent a device because our international travelers don't want to deal with bandwidth issues, and they don't want to deal with battery life, right? So they take the device. But New Yorkers and others can use this, and obviously you can as well. I want to tell you a couple of lessons from our Met app that we created. The Met app is something we're very proud of on iOS and Android. And these are three lessons from how we thought about our app. We want it to be useful, simple, and delightful. Useful, simple, delightful. And what that means is that I think a lot of organizations often, whatever the opposite of these things are, is how they get started, right? Like if you're in journalism, if you're starting something, we're going to start by winning a Pulitzer Prize is the first goal, right? Or, by the way, if you ever get invited to a meeting that says viral video meeting, do not go to that meeting, right? Like, that's not a good idea, right? Do not go to that. So useful, simple, delightful. What is the app on the extreme right? What is that app? It is not the New York Times app. What is it? Anybody know? It's NYT Now, which is a free version of the New York Times that I recommend everybody get. It's only 30% of the New York Times, but it's the right 30%. And it's really, really worth looking at. It also has the best coverage of breaking news and when San Bernardino, Paris, et cetera, happened. TripIt, anyone here using TripIt? Look around you. I don't know how anyone travels without TripIt. It's a trip organizing app, not a trip booking app. Moves is an app that tracks your steps. I try to walk 10,000 steps a day, that's about 5 miles, and I'm really disappointed that Kevin's holding my phone so I'm not getting any steps in, which is how I track my steps. You can run around with me, we'll just run around like a Bollywood film, right? We'll just be running around. Dark Sky, anybody know Dark Sky? Raise your hand. Okay, Dark Sky is a $3 weather app. You say, why would you spend $3 on a weather app when all weather is free and Al Roker's on TV all the time, right? But I use it because it does one thing really well. It'll tell you whether it's raining or it's going to rain or snow where you're standing in the next hour. And it sounds almost magical, which it is, and it has never failed me. But it's also like Waze. Do you know this app called Waze that tells you how the traffic, that when you first saw it, that was magic, but now it's normal. And that's the world we're heading toward, right? Where something that's magic becomes every day. And that's what's happened with Dark Sky, Waze, all of those things. We have a media lab where we're working on the future of culture, and I'm really excited to talk to Young Moo and his team at Excite to see how we can work together on the future of culture and R&D, and we want to be a group space for all of us as we're working together. Here's an example of something I referred to earlier. We can't be in the business of always selling tickets, selling books, buy tickets to our dance performance. We can't be that. We have a Google Chrome extension called Meow Met. And what this is once you download it on your Chrome browser, every time you open a new tab, you get a fresh cat from the Met's collection. Applause is absolutely the right response to that. And the people who are really interested can click and go into the collection record and get the full details of what's happening in there. That's fine. But otherwise, what you're doing is being a part of people's lives when you don't ask them for something, right? Of course, now people are asking us, where is the dog met? Where is someone said giraffe met and all of this stuff. So what do? We're not going to create all this, right? We're going to make the APIs so that people can take them and make whatever they want with them, right? That's where we have to go. I was at the Yale Center for British Art, which has just rehung its entire collection, and they have made all their artwork free for commercial and non-commercial use. They say, you want to make a beach towel? Go ahead. It's kind of refreshing to hear them talk about that in that way. It's very, very exciting. You can do that now. Want to talk a little bit about social media? We doubled our social media team to 2 people, and we have up there their names. You can see Taylor C. Newby and Museum Mama. That's Kim, Museum Mammy, I'm sorry. Museum Mammy is Kim Drew, and Taylor Newby is at Taylor C. Newby. I hope you'll follow them on Twitter and Instagram. On Monday, we host the Met Gala, which I don't get to attend, before you ask, because suddenly, when I joined the Met, people became very friendly to me because they thought they get to attend the Met Gala, and I had to tell them I don't get to go, and you're certainly not going. But our team is going to be working there, and they've got an amazing way of doing their social media work. So I hope you'll connect with them, watch how they're doing their stuff, and just two people, how they plan their editorial calendar and what they're able to do is so inspiring to me about how you run social media with just two people. We have a program up at the Met called GMLC, the Global Museum Leaders Colloquium, where we bring museum directors from developing countries to spend 2 weeks at the Met. And as you can imagine, they're mostly from smaller institutions. And when you sit at these, you know, in the security presentation, there are 600 guards, things like that. And at my presentation, I said, we have two social media people. And the director from Peru said, yes, I have two social media people also. And then she said, and I'm going to fire one of them now because I can't have the same number of anything as the Met. So I said, please don't fire her. Please don't fire him or her. We all need more people. But the point is that social media is about working together, having great planning, and being very disciplined about what you do. And that's what you see, how we're able to produce all this content. Two people are doing this, right? A lot of different channels. We're also on Weibo, which is the large Chinese network. We just joined WeChat, which is a bigger Chinese network. Why? Because Chinese are the largest number of overseas visitors to the Met. And I'm just going to go on here and just tell you about Tom, who I mentioned earlier, and his work on Instagram is a great example for all of you to think about in how leaders can use social. People often tell me the reason I'm not using social media is because I'm too busy. Well, I've seen Tom's calendar. I know how busy he is. But he's also very strategic in the way he uses it. So what I mean by that is, he was named, by the way, one of the 23 best art Instagrams in the world, and that was mostly when he was on his iPhone 4S. He now has a 6, so watch out, world. He's going to be great. So I asked him once, how come you're getting such great traction? Some of you who know him know that he is known as Tapestry Tom. He's an expert on Renaissance tapestry. And he says, you know, the tapestry was the Instagram of 1655 or whatever, right? It was square, you had to tell a story, et cetera. But what Tom is doing is a new kind of leadership. I saw at one 10-page, 10-post stretch, 9 of them were about other museums. And I was like, boss, talk about us. Think about any other industry where a CEO would be posting generously about other people in his or her space. I can't think of another one. But I understood what he was doing, which I didn't know, I didn't realize what he was doing. He was posting from a place of confidence, a place of generosity, and a place of transparency, which people love online. And he doesn't post every day or every minute, but he finds the time to post. And he's now doing Facebook as well, so you can follow him there and see what he's doing. I want to tell you the dirty secret of social media. That almost everyone will miss almost everything you do until you make a mistake. And then everyone will see it. We had talked earlier about the Knight Foundation was referred to earlier, right? Victoria Rogers from the Knight Foundation runs the arts program. And my former colleague, Jennifer Preston, runs the journalism program. And look what she said. Show excellent judgment on Twitter. There's nothing more valuable than that. I spend 3 to 6 minutes on every tweet I write. And you're thinking, boy, this guy doesn't get a lot done. It's true. He doesn't have a real life. True. Why do I do that? Because social media is the only thing I do today that can get me fired today. Social media is the only thing I do today that can get me divorced today. And Twitter is the only thing I'll ever do that will ever be in the library of Congress, right? I know some of you didn't know that, and you're thinking, what do I need to delete right now, right? But I also, not to be macabre, but every tweet I write as if it's my last tweet. As I head to 30th Street Station, I get hit by a bus, I guarantee you somebody will pull out the tweet and say, here was his last tweet. And I experienced this a little bit with my father, who is very much alive and doing great. But he was excited about a conference, and he said, I'm excited to host my conference in Kerala, India. And then when he was at the conference, he was beaten by some thugs at the conference. And he's doing fine, as I said. But the evening news in Kerala, India was Mr. Sreenivasan was attacked and beaten at his own conference, and here's the tweet that he sent out saying he's excited about this. So I always think about that. And the lesson is pay close attention to what you're posting. Since we've talked a lot about the Met, I didn't want to end without sharing a couple of thoughts about another great institution that's older than us. I like to think that we're doing a startup inside a 150-year-old company, and Harvard in many ways also works as a startup in some places. And you can see they're on Flickr, YouTube, et cetera. The CDO of Harvard is a woman named Perry Hewitt, at Perry Hewitt. She runs one of the most useful newsletters in the world that you should all subscribe to. It's called the Friday Five. You go on her Twitter feed, you subscribe to it. Every Friday, you get five digital ideas. It will change the way you look at the world. So please subscribe to her, at Perry Hewitt. And she, and say we're talking about you in Philly. And so they have all these things, but they also have an animated GIF or GIF channel on Jiffy. Think about that for a second. Every time they send out a press release, they consider sending along an animated GIF or GIF. So when people ask me about innovation at the Met or at your opera company or your dance company, I'll say nothing you suggest could be as unlikely as Harvard having a Giphy channel, right? What are the chances of that? So I'm going to pause here and take a couple of questions from you folks. Yeah. The artist project, yeah, the artist project is a great example. I have videos of all of those things, but in the interest of time, but thank you for mentioning it. So the artist project is one of several digital projects that we do at the Met to bring the collection alive. And the artist project is 100 artists talking about their favorite works of art at the Met. We did a previous series called 82nd and 5th where 100 curators talked about their favorite arts pieces of art at the Met. And those are the videos that we've been doing to tell our stories. We have another great project called #MetKids, which is a project that brings the Met alive for kids 7 through 12. And it's made for, by, and about kids. So those are examples of videos that we're doing. Other questions? Yeah. Right, yeah, absolutely. And I didn't show you this slide here, but it's more important to not just have numbers, but to have engagement. We were named the most influential museum on Twitter, even though we're only the 7th most followed museum. And I would say that engagement is everything. And you know, there are all these fake view numbers that you can get. You can buy viewers, things like that. But this is the magic. And this is not really about the Met. Look at number 5, the 5th most influential person in the museum sector is a woman named Mar Dixon, who some of you know, at Mar Dixon. And she lives in Shropshire, England, and is more influential than all of those museums. How is that possible? Because she's a node in the conversation about museums. We're that big blue in the middle, but she's one of the other blues. And I tell people, you need to be the Mar Dixon of your field, of your city. That's what you need to be doing. So, the Met has been digital long before we got there. They launched their first website in October 95, a year before the New York Times, a year before the Wall Street Journal, right? The Wall Street Journal just celebrating its 20th anniversary, WSJ.com, 3 years before Google. So it's how do we keep adjusting to what's happening around us? Let's do a couple more questions, yeah. Yeah, so the question was how do you stay efficient on social media? So it's not easy, I would say, because social media is so distracting, and on the phone it's really distracting because of the notifications, right? And you have this reflex like what's happened. And there are tools, by the way. If those of you who write grant proposals and essays or whatever you're writing, books, you should put in some of these tools that block off access to the internet while you're writing, just to kind of focus your mind. If you're on your phone and you're reading something on a PDF or in an iPad, going to airplane mode is really good because that'll focus you. But there are tools like Hootsuite. Anybody using Hootsuite is a good tool for keeping track of posting to multiple platforms, thinking about your content, and also post-dating your tweets, scheduling your tweets and Facebook posts changes everything, because then you're not having to do it all throughout the day. You can do it in the morning. If you have money, you use a tool called Social Flow, which is an expensive but very good tool for scheduling your tweet. But the answer is really discipline, and I have none of it. So that's the thing. We'll do one more question, and then we got to stop. Yeah.
What was the tool that you used to find your most influential?
Ah, good. Somebody remembered. All right. So I'm going to show you that, and then I'm going to give you my social media success formula, and then we're going to stop. And I'm going to hopefully make the train. I understand we're close to the 30th Street Station, so let's see. So the tool I use is called Twiangulate. Anyone seen this? All right, it's run by a guy named Henry Copeland, who's at HC on Twitter, at HC. So I'm just going to sign, oops, sorry. I'm just going to go to Reach Of, and I'm going to put in here, Phila Culture, right? That's our, they're our hosts, so we're going to do a little exercise with them. Sign in with Twitter. What's the most common password in the world? Password, right? That's not my password, by the way. All right. By the way, I apologize for my face being there. I said something nice about them, so they. So here it is. So Phila Culture, are the Phila Culture people here? We're doing. Yeah, there you are. Kevin and others are here. So here we go. You have 16,000 followers, right? That's a very good number of followers. But look at your 100 top followers have 10 million followers. Does everybody see that? Why is this valuable? Because in social media, it's not who follows you that matters. It's who follows you that matters, right? It's so easy to get followers. You can buy 100,000 followers for like $200. That's what Newt Gingrich did. You know, before he announced for president, two cycles ago, he had 50,000 followers, and as soon as he announced he had 2 million followers, those are not voters, right? Those were he was buying them. So look at that, 10 million followers. That's amazing. So who are your biggest followers? Who do you think are your biggest followers? Anybody know? So I presume the mayor, the city of Philadelphia, Carson Wentz, not yet, but you know, you probably not heard of. He doesn't know much about Philadelphia, I presume. Or is he from Philly? I don't know. Does anybody know? Where's he from? North. He's from North, but that's the university. But did he also study there? Okay, here we go. So MoMA follows you. That's really nice. ArtNet, ArtInfo, Beth Cantor. This is so interesting. So Beth is, tweet at her, folks. She's amazing. Beth has 400,000 followers, and she is the leading expert on technology and nonprofits. And she wrote a wonderful column on Tom Campbell and how he's doing leadership. You must read that. It says, how you use Instagram for museum leadership, arts leadership. So there she is, Beth Cantor. Action News is following you, Philly 29. Eventbrite is following you. Ali Velshi, some of you know him from CNN and from Al Jazeera America, he's following you. So tweet at him and just say, hey, at Ali Velshi, we see you here. He lives in Philadelphia, his Philadelphia connection, so you should connect with him, philly.com, et cetera, et cetera. Now you also see who is not following you, right? You can get a sense of who's not following you. You get these 100, and you can look at that. So the other thing that you can do, what is the power of someone following you? That you can DM them, you can direct message them. That's the power of somebody following you, and that's even more powerful than email or anything else. So now we're going to go to my social media success formula, and then we're done. Let me just go. Okay, so I'm going to give you my social media success formula. You'll probably want to pull out your cameras for this. And it's a formula that will help you. And we're going to pretend we're in a Catholic church or a Baptist church on Sunday led by a Hindu priest. It's a weird church. All right? And we're going to say these words out loud. Are you ready? Yeah. Are you ready? Yes! Hallelujah! All right, here we go. All right. We're going to start with the word helpful. All right, and by the way, if you feel like standing up and screaming, that's also okay. All right, ready? We start with the word helpful.
Helpful.
Useful. Louder.
Timely.
Can't hear you.
Informative.
Sing it, sister.
Actionable.
Say it, brother.
Actionable.
Take me home, mama. Louder. Man, you've never been to a Baptist Hindu church? That's what we do. Think think about this. This is not saying that all your posts need to be all of these things, but all your posts need to be some of these things. And if you do that, you're going to be what you already are. You're great in real life. You're going to be awesome on social media. Speaking of social media, I host Social Media Weekend on June 10 and 11 in New York City at CUNY Journalism School in Times Square. I think we have about 50 tickets left. If anybody wants to come, it's pinned to the top of my Twitter feed so you can look at it. Send your friends or your enemies, depending. Don't tell them anything and just send them to it. But I just want to say that we said that the scarcest resource is human attention, and you guys just gave me an hour of your attention. Thank you very much, everybody.